Members, can I just ask any member who hasn't received the notice of the amendments yet just to raise their hands, please? Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Webber. We'll ensure that reaches you. And Mercedes Vialba. Thank you. I call Megan Gallagher for a point of order.
On a point of order, Presiding Officer, I'm concerned by the scheduling of business in this Parliament. As a new mum, I am already struggling to find childcare during regular work hours, let alone until late at night. Last week's business proposal said we'd be here until 11:30 tonight, so I made the best possible arrangements I could. Today's revision could mean that we will be here until late tonight and tomorrow too. Can I firstly ask you, Presiding Officer, similar to my colleague Jeremy Balfour's point of order, whether any parliamentary processes exist which include impact assessments on the effects of scheduling of new business on new parents? And I ask this because at the close of last term, several MSPs stood down citing an impossibility of working here while raising a young family, and I fear that matters are getting worse. Secondly, can I ask you whether it is your understanding that it would be possible within parliamentary processes for this week's Stage 3 amendment consideration to have been split into three sessions, with the final debate on the Gender Recognition Reform Bill being moved into the first week back in January, which currently has a blank slot on Tuesday the 10th? Thank you.
I thank Ms. Gallagher for her point of order. It certainly is the case that some of the matters the members raises are not matters for standing orders and therefore are not matters for me to rule on from the chair. As I have said to Mr. Balfour, there will be breaks built into this afternoon. The Parliamentary Bureau is the party, is the forum which decides business for the Parliament, the cross-party Parliamentary Bureau. Now, we have not yet got to the point of making a decision on the timetabling of the business. That is what is currently being debated at the moment, and we will continue in that vein. Thank you very much, Ms. Gallagher. Point of order, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm not sure, but I myself have a spreadsheet on my computer right now with a waiting list of members of the public desperate to get into the gallery today, and at the moment it doesn't appear to be particularly full, given I know the how many people are looking to get into the proceedings.
I thank Ms. Webber for her point, which is not a matter that I would normally rule on from the chair. I am aware that tickets have been allocated and that our visitor services colleagues will be dealing with this matter at this moment. Point of order, Pauline McNeill.
Sir, I want to raise a point of order in relation to the groupings. Could you just advise me whether I should do that now or would it be after this particular debate? I just wanted to make sure that you knew I was going to raise it. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Ms. McNeill. I would suggest that we take that point of order later when we reach that point in the proceedings. We will now carry on with these proceedings, and I call on Graeme Simpson to speak to and move Amendment 7320.2.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I completely agree with everything that's been said by Mr. Burnett, Mr. Balfour, and other colleagues about the proceedings today. Presiding Officer, I'll move the amendment in my name, which colleagues have now had the chance to read. It's an amendment to the business motion, and it calls for a statement tomorrow on the Strategic Transport Projects Review number 2. And this was issued by the Scottish Government at the end of the week, nearly 2 weeks ago. There's been no parliamentary time allocated to it so far, no debate, no questions, nothing. And yet, this eagerly awaited document could have far-reaching consequences. We should, as a Parliament, expect to have statements on important matters such as this as soon as the documents are issued. There is simply no good reason for the Government to avoid being questioned on STPR2, unless, of course, they don't fancy the undoubtedly tough grilling they would get.
Yeah. From you?
Yes, from me. and others. Because to say that STPR2 is a damp squib is a massive understatement. If you live in the South West and we're hoping to get some good news on upgrading the A75 or the A77, then you're still waiting. If you wanted to find out when the A9 would be fully duelled between Perth and Inverness, then this document is not for you, I'm afraid. You would think it might be. There were lots of warm words that offered cold comfort for communities the length and breadth of Scotland. If you rely on Scotland's ageing ferry fleet, there's nothing for you in STPR2. There are plenty of ifs, buts and maybes, but no firm commitments to build bridges and tunnels or improve ports. There is no ferry replacement plan. We must wait for that, I suppose. There are the usual platitudes, of course, about wanting to cut car miles by a fifth within 7 years, but just how that is going to be achieved is anyone's guess. You certainly won't discover the answers from this document. And on railways, we have conflicting statements. To quote, the document says, the plan includes the following statement in relation to transport. By 2032, we will have decarbonised our passenger railways. Then it goes on to say, by 2032, Scotland's passenger rail services will be considerably decarbonised, with just a few years to go until they're fully decarbonised. Not the same thing. Now, the point is, all this gives MSPs much to chew over, but with no chance to question the Minister. Instead, we have the farce of this week, and we've been through it already. A potential midnight sitting tonight, another late one tomorrow. Presiding Officer, we should be having statements on things like SDPR2 and dealing, we should be dealing with important matters like that that affect all our constituents and all our constituencies. Thank you.
I call on Liam Kerr to speak to and move Amendment 7320.3.
Very grateful, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I rise to request that tomorrow's business be adjusted to include a ministerial statement on the Government's biodiversity strategy, which was laid in Parliament on the 13th of December 2022. And for the benefit of the Chamber, that is the amendment that I have lodged. Presiding Officer, this strategy is incredibly timely, given that just yesterday at COP15, the Biodiversity Summit, which many worry too often plays second fiddle to the climate conference COP, a deal was sealed on a new global biodiversity framework. Some have called this a Paris moment for nature. In it, nations adopted 4 goals and 23 targets for 2030 to protect our lands, our coasts, and our inland waters. Presiding Officer, the loss of species and degradation of our natural environment is an existential threat to humanity, which requires that we take urgent and transformative action. Indeed, Minister Lorna Slater states at the beginning of the biodiversity strategy, this is an emergency that requires an emergency response. Yep. Yeah. Indeed it does. And that's why we must hear a ministerial statement without delay, yeah, noting it's already a week old, and waiting several weeks for recess fails to recognise the importance of this strategy. Presiding Officer, it's important that this is put into context. Scottish Forestry only created 9,500 hectares of new woodland last year, against the Scottish Government target of 13,500 for 21-22. The Government's State of Nature Scotland report states that species abundance has shown a marked and continual decline in the past 10 years, and more generally, 49% of species have decreased. The ferret just reported a year ago that 531 habitats and 603 species in Scotland are in poor condition, including island and upland habitats. Species in poor condition and in decline include the Scottish wildcat, the hedgehog, the capercaillie and the Arctic skua. The Net Zero Committee heard just this morning from the Climate Change Committee on the importance of peatland restoration, yet the government's target of 20,000 hectares per year was missed by well over 10,000 hectares. In that context, the biodiversity strategy is key. And we heard from the Climate Change Committee's report and their evidence this morning that data, monitoring and proper planning are imperative to achieving what we all want. And therefore, Presiding Officer, it is vital that ministers appear before this Parliament so MSPs can interrogate the monitoring and evaluation framework that will be used to check we're meeting our biodiversity targets, to ensure that we see how stakeholder engagement will be carried out and the importance of engaging the public in buying into the biodiversity strategy, because that's key to successful outcomes. And of course, whether the priority actions set out for 2030 are the most appropriate for achieving our biodiversity goals. So whilst I do appreciate that we are in a tight timescale before the Christmas recess, the biodiversity and nature crisis will not wait, and nor should we. Presiding Officer, I respectfully ask Parliament to grant me a ministerial statement on the biodiversity strategy tomorrow, and therefore I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I call on Stephen Kerr to speak to and move amendment 7320.4.
Presiding Officer, last week we had a plethora of annual statistics released about Scotland's education system. These statistics, I believe, ought to have been a focus of the business of this Parliament last week, but because they could cause all of us to sit up and take notice. We should have had the opportunity, I believe, to have heard last week from the Cabinet Secretary, but we didn't. I tried every way which I knew how to get this issue into the business papers of Parliament, but was unsuccessful. We have just had a topical question that was answered, in part at least, by the Minister, in relation to some of the evidence that has been delivered through this statistical release, namely that we have fewer teachers and more pupils and therefore greater class sizes, and as a consequence of the budget on top of that, we are looking at councils now talking about having shorter periods, shorter school days, shorter school weeks, and there is the question of the diminishing range of subject choice that is available to our young people in secondary schools. On top of that, as I've already mentioned, there is the question of the rising class sizes as ratios are ditched for financial expediency in some part, but largely through the neglect of the Scottish Government. And as has also been mentioned, there is grave concern among teachers about a number of issues, not least of which is the level of classroom violence that they encounter. And teachers ought not to have to worry about their safety in the classroom. I would say, Presiding Officer, that if we aren't focused as a Parliament on the quality of our children's education and the clear issues we are facing in the education system, especially in the aftermath of the pandemic, then all I can say is that we ought to be. And that is why I want a statement, a ministerial statement, inserted into the business of this chamber tomorrow, so that the government can come to this Parliament in the form of the Cabinet Secretary or a minister and be scrutinised on the basis of the data that we now are in possession of. The decline in the number of teachers in our schools and other data that has been released through the summary statistics for schools in Scotland 2022. As I say, sadly, the sum total of this data does not make pretty reading. But that perhaps explains why the Scottish Government have been so reluctant to come to this chamber and to make a statement. It might also explain why the Scottish Government have removed Scotland from international league tables for education. Because I'm afraid those league tables and the limited data that we have available to us would undoubtedly show, and indeed do show, that the SNP have mismanaged our education system, and there is a need for greater scrutiny of this policy area, perhaps than any other policy area. But I do frankly worry that there is worse to come, Presiding Officer, because of the budget and because of the commentary that there has been plenty of in the media about the consequences that flow from this budget. There is going to be another round of real terms cuts to local government, and this will undoubtedly have an impact on the education system, which is a big ticket item for every local authority. And there will be an impact as well on extracurricular activities, which add so much to children's experience at school. So in conclusion, Scottish education used to be the envy of the world. But the limited data we have available to us now shows that there have been 15 years of mismanagement at the hands of this government. And many of us in this place believe that Scotland's children and young people deserve better. And that's why it's imperative that the SNP government make a statement about the curriculum for excellence data, and that should happen tomorrow, as I'm suggesting, so that we can begin a more serious look at these statistics in the context of the work of this Parliament, which is fundamentally why the people of Scotland elect us.
Thank you. I now call on George Adam to respond on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, just to say to a number of colleagues, perhaps if they'd spoken to their business manager and put some of these points across, then he would have been able to argue that point at Bureau, which is the place, obviously, for us to have these discussions in an open and frank manner. So with that in mind, Presiding Officer, I want to stand by the business programme that we agreed earlier today at Bureau, and I would suggest that we carry on that way. Sorry, I'll take an intervention from Mr.
Neil Bibby.
Thank the Minister for taking the intervention. The Minister will be aware that we have called for a number of statements, including on STPR2 and educational attainment, and I put on record again our support for these, and I hope the Government will bring them forward early in the new year. We have been clear that the debate should not be curtailed on the Gender Recognition Reform Bill, and have indeed ensured the bill was delayed to this week, originally scheduled to be held over 2 days, and the final day debate was doubled in length following our requests. The Conservatives, meanwhile, say they want extra debate time on this, but are evidently now wasting time while we should be scrutinising that legislation before. As I said before, we do not wish to curtail debate on this, and we have never at any stage. So on that issue, Minister, does the Minister agree with my understanding that the Presiding Officer would normally allow every member who wishes to speak the opportunity to do so in legislation?
believe the minister, the presiding officer actually mentioned during the meeting how that she was of the mind that she was going to take as many people as possible to ensure that everybody got their opportunity to say their piece during this passing of legislation, as which is the case normally. But with regards to Mr Bibby's questions on statement, Mr Bibby quite rightly worked as a business manager through the Business Bureau, and we found a way to find some common ground to bring these statements at a later date, as we agreed. And, presiding officer, that is the way we work within this Parliament.
Thank you. I call Alexander Burnett. Point of order.
Thank you, presiding officer. Can I ask your advice how a member or minister might correct the record? I think the correspondence, both my position at Bureau and a very clearly documented email correspondence between ourselves, would be contrary to what the minister has suggested, that we have not been seeking to improve the timetable for this bill. And could perhaps the presiding officer remind the minister of how he might correct the record, because he has still failed to come to the chamber, where he misled it the previous time, where he said that the decision was unanimous, and I'm not sure if the minutes have been published of the committee, of the Bureau, but when they are, they clearly show that decision was not unanimous, and I trust the presiding officer will be able to instruct the minister accordingly.
Thank you. The content of members' contributions is not ordinarily a matter for the Chair. Members will be aware of the corrections mechanism and how to use that should they wish to correct anything that has been recorded on the official report. We now move to putting the question. And the question is that Amendment 7320.1 in the name of Alexander Burnett, which seeks to amend Business Motion 7320 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to this week's business, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote, and there'll be a short suspension, a brief pause to allow members to access digital voting.